Several years ago, a bunch of writers made a pitch to reimagine Superman, basically bring Superman to the forefront of superheroes, give him his legacy back, make him the most popular hero. This is what they claimed they would do for him, that they would make him, basically the topple Spawn and every Marvel comic that's currently in his way. And the writers also said, we didn't think this would be a problem. They called this pitch Superman 2000. And who was responsible? Mark Millar, Grant Morrison, Tom Peyer, and Mort Weisinger. Let's dig into this pitch. Hey, everybody, this is Perch. It's funny, I didn't realize a lot of people do not know this story because there's a lot of attention around Mort Weisinger in particular, and then to some extent, Mark Millar and Grant Morrison and kind of the feud between the two of them. It's interesting. I thought everybody knew this story, but basically, there was a pitch for Superman that these four kind of came together to sell themselves for writing Superman. And what's interesting about this is that this set off a bit of a firestorm within DC, which is a video for another time, but it answers the question some people have had, which is, you know, is Mort Weisinger blacklisted at DC? And the answer is, well, not exactly, but sort of. But the reason why a lot of that stuff kicked off is, you know, can be traced back to this exact pitch. Now, of course, Grant Morrison continues to have a very successful career at DC. Mark Millar's off doing Netflix. Tom Peyer's, you know, doing his thing. And Mort Weisinger is over at Marvel. But this was an interesting pitch, and it's interesting to look in hindsight. So the idea was, and I think part of what got people really upset was that it was largely unsolicited, or was it? It was unclear who solicited these guys to make this pitch. So it came across as being kind of arrogant and sticking their nose where it didn't belong. The Superman editorial office didn't ask for it, and that's a whole other video of he said, she said, a million people said. I mentioned this, and I always get people always tell me, no, you've got it wrong. No, that's not what happened. Yeah, you're not relaying history correctly. But the problem is everyone has a different version of that history. So I think nobody has ever told a coherent story here. But the pitch about Superman, because that's what we're in for, was all about making him more relevant as a superhero. So the high-level points were, first of all, they were going to in effect, triple his powers, that his body has been collecting solar radiation all this time, and it's he has this kind of evolutionary leap forward, where he's three times smarter, three times more powerful, three times the champion for the downtrodden and the marginalized people, three times everything. So Superman gets a big power boost a little bit. And he's able to, you know, scan the entire environment in an instant with levels of perception we can only imagine. So really taking advantage of kind of his ability to have his microscopic vision, have more the thinking man's Superman. So rather than the brute strength of being able to fly around, really highlighting the fact that his brain's more powerful, he can do more. And putting it more on maybe even footing with the Luthors and Brainiacs of the world. So, and then we kind of get into what do we want to do with Superman. Now, here's the interesting part. And this was going to be a big retcon back in his history. It was going to involve him getting trained by the JSA and no bad Superman, no crazy Superman stories for a while. I have a hard time, Mr. Millar, believing you there, but it's fine. But basically, they're really going to go with the truth, justice, the world way. Big smile, instant handshake, frighteningly quick and clever, curiosity and kindness, and that he would definitely support the smaller voices, the people who need defending, not protect the downtrodden from the one percenters out there. They wanted to, of course, because this is everybody's pitch, they want to tweak his costume by having him get rid of the red trunks. So finally, Superman's smart enough to wear his shorts under his pants. I don't know why this is a lightning rod for so many writers. It's like, oh, all the things. They really gravitate toward the red underwear. It makes me feel like there's a hang-up in people's minds. They just can't deal with that underwear. Anyway, so lots and lots of tweaks to his backstory and other pieces. But the other big phase was kind of immediately it gets into Lois Lane and the idea of we've got to dissolve this marriage. And very much feeding into what Dan Didio, and Dan Didio basically, you know, part of the, you know, the other video about Mark Waid and kind of his time at DC, part of that story was that James Robinson was fired and Mark Waid was brought in, and then they realized they actually couldn't do that, so Mark Waid was then let go and Robinson was brought back, and you could see some of, you know, Didio's views on marriage even dates way back to this pitch. And I'm not saying just Didio. Lots of people in the comic industry have the same idea. It's like, how do we dissolve this marriage? And it's interesting to see these four writers, many of which are, you know, Grant Morrison, Mark Millar. These are legends in a lot of cases in comics. And they all immediately came to a conclusion. We've got to get rid of the marriage. And then they spend lots of time kind of, you know, messing about with that. The concept they came up with is that there's a huge, you know, big story mid-year, a global mess where Luthor and Brainiac are they've unearthed Superman's secret identity, and they tell the world his identity is exposed. Clark Kent is Superman, and everybody gets to know it. By the way, at this point, just kind of think in the back of your head, what does all this stuff remind you of? Anyway, so it's like we're going to expose the identity, and his family, it gets attacked. The parasite is attacking his parents and hospitalizing them, and they're near death's door, and it's just wrecking all of the people that his secret identity protected now are exposed because a secret identity is out there. In the giant battle, a virus basically gets put into Lois in her memory, so that the chemical memory of Clark's secret identity is actually killing her. So if it can't be removed, it could be masked. But if she ever found out that and she's the smartest, best reporter in the world, everybody loves Lois Lane, she'll eventually remember again that Clark Kent was Superman, and that memory will kill her. And so, with no conceivable option, Superman turns to Mitzelplick. And sure, says Mixie, I can fix this, but only by altering history so that she never knew, so that there was never a memory to poison. That sounds familiar. Anyway, so Superman and him bicker back and forth, and Superman goes and talks about it with Lois, and they come to the conclusion in order to protect those around them, to protect Lois, to protect, you know, Clark's family, his parents, John and Martha Kent, that what would have to be happened is that the spell will be woven and night will fall and the entire world will forget that Superman is Clark Kent, and they will fall asleep one more time, wrapped around each other. They one last kiss, they drift off into slumber, and when dawn breaks in Metropolis, Clark Kent exits his bachelor apartment at 344 Clinton Avenue, makes it to the Daily Planet just in time to catch the latest in a long line of caustic barbs from rival reporter Lois Lane. She has her sights set on Superman, thinks Kent for the millionth time. If only I could get her to love me as Clark. I'm just saying, you know, interesting pitch. I wonder if that would work for other characters like Spider-Man. I mean, conceivably, if they wanted to get rid of Spider-Man and Mary Jane's marriage, they could do something similar. And I'll bet the fans would really go for it. I don't know why they didn't do this with Superman. I mean, certainly the reaction would have been amazing. Anyway, it goes on and on to basically the big premise is that we're going to boost up the villains, definitely in support of that. We're going to make Superman smarter and help find more kind of, key things. We're going to, bring elements of the kingdom in place. We're going to bring up the vault, so the Superman lair, and really do a lot with characters like Brainiac and Luthor and Bizarro, but then also Metallo, Kryptonite Man, Solaris, Toyman, Prankster, kind of all these different pieces. And Mitzelplick would be this kind of mix of a hero villain, kind of like we have now. But the other part of this pitch was that the writing process was going to be very different. The idea was that the four would work kind of in tandem to create kind of these general outlines of plots, and then Peyer and Waid would work to kind of create the dialogue and they talk about how this collection would really helm the Superman books and bring it to bear. So that was the pitch. It was obviously not accepted, but it was interesting to see which aspects of that did kind of filter out. If you look at the new 52 Superman and what was done, there are certainly elements that were picked up here. They definitely, everybody's off after the red underwear. And then Mark Millar would go on to the Marvel, where he would do Civil War and certainly, help be part of the process that revealed Peter's identity. You could see Joe Quesada seeing this pitch and, going, hey, we can steal aspects of this and use it for Spider-Man. And certainly that's what was also done. So it provides some interesting perspective into this marriage and kind of this way of rebuilding characters. But this was a real thing. This was a pitch that big, legitimate, known writers that we all know would do. Grant Morrison, of course, would go on to do Batman. And it's, in hindsight, it's interesting. It's always interesting to see what people think are the right answers for, boosting up characters, giving them a fresh coat of paint, trying to do other things. But this was Superman 2000, certainly created a lot of ripples around the industry, both for Superman, for the artists and creators involved, for where the same story it is would get picked up and reused for other characters. And it's part of the reason why people like Mark Waid do not work at DC today. So it's interesting to see all this comic history. There's a million stories like this, but pitches like this are always interesting. This one coming in unsolicited created an extra little wrinkle of politics to the whole thing. Comics are fascinating, what can I say? But what do you think? Is this a Superman you would have liked? Is this a storyline that would have really, done it for you and you would be excited to read? What do you think about a trio or four-person writing team? Is this something that could work places? Again, this was also tried with Spider-Man back in the time before Dan Slott fully took over the title. They were also trying this kind of, collective approach. And it's one of those things that it's an idea that keeps getting pitched in comics and maybe even people try it, but it almost always gets reverted. It never works out like the creators say it will or want it to. The idea seems better than the execution in a lot of cases. But what do you think? Leave me a comment below. Let me know your thoughts on it. Like, subscribe, a little bit of comic history. If you want to ask me questions about something else, follow me on Twitter at Comic Perch or Facebook at the same, or just leave a comment below. Most importantly, thanks for listening.